I met Imam Malik in the midst of one of the most difficult times of my life, and he was a great encouragement, as was Naima. And just a couple of days ago, I was on Radio Islam for the second time. So I feel like I'm a regular now. I feel like I'm at home. I was asked to speak about following Jesus in America today. And as I thought about my answer to that question, a lot of thoughts went through my head. As I've sat here this evening and listened to various speakers, I've heard things that resonate with me as a Christian. Imam Muhammad just spoke about walking, and the gospel literally is putting feet to our faith. The Apostle Paul calls Christians to walk worthy of the gospel of Christ. And what that means is, given the times and the context, because theology and our faith is always contextual, what does it mean to embody the faith? What does it mean to speak our faith? What does it mean to live out our faith? But the question of context, America, the United States, people of faith, I think, are called also to transcend. I follow Jesus in spite of the United States, and sometimes following Jesus requires the United States actions. You honor the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, by keeping the pillars of Islam, not because you are American, but in spite of your Americanness. The truths of the universe, the one God that we serve, is neither confined to national boundaries nor conformed to the temporality of emirs, presidents, emperors, and empires. The mountains tremble, the earth shakes, kingdoms rise and fall, but God remains the same. I follow Jesus because his love compels me to do so. When you look in a mirror and you see that you have changed by an encounter with the divine, you can do no less than live out that love in radical ways. Ways that make you an embodied question mark everywhere you go. A prophet, standing with the prophet, standing against false prophets who masquerade as presidential candidates. Being a prophet against injustice, instigated by demagogues and sycophants in the name of keeping America great, inequalities perpetuated by government in the name of maintaining false economic hegemony over our supposed foes who are actually fellow humans and therefore not our enemies at all, and discrimination motivated by fear of the other, fear of our neighbor across the street and across the globe. Fear is perpetuated too often in the name of nationalism, in the name of the civil religion, in God we trust on our money. But in reality, this country seems to trust mammon more than God. Don't get me wrong, I'm not denouncing the country of my birth, the country that brought my ancestors as slaves and called us less than human. I'm not an immigrant or a refugee, and I'm talking to a group of people who understand about the fact that my Americanness is a contested identity for me in 2016, just as your identity as a Muslim is a contested identity for you. To folks who don't accept me as American enough, I say, I know that I've come this far by faith, because the religion of the oppressor, the slave master, the one who had my ancestors recite the Bible he had tweaked to subject him to chattel slavery, has actually become the rock of my salvation. In case you haven't noticed already, you are too Muslim by America's standards. You may be as white as George Washington, but if you worship at a mosque or bow toward Mecca, even in designated prayer rooms at the airport, you are not American enough. So it seems like we need each other. A collective effort, a collective consciousness that transcends our differences, because God is one, even if America says our lives don't matter. Or we're not American. So what does it mean to follow Jesus in this country at this time? Jesus was prophet, priest, and king. Christ followers are people of Easter, which we just celebrated, people of the resurrection. we live with the hope that Jesus' death brings us life, that even though prophets are without honor in their own time, we are called to speak truth to power like the prophets, because we know that true power is humble and seeks to honor the least and the weak, not the greatest. It seeks to give alms to the poor. It seeks to give and live sacrificially. Because for Christians in the body of Christ, all are one and all hierarchies are leveled and flattened. There are no zero-sum games. There's only God's abundance where all are fed and filled. Following Jesus for me means walking with the most vulnerable, like my Muslim sisters. Those who are suffering, oppressed, maligned, castigated to the shadows because they are minorities. Because their bodies evoke fear in countries more concerned about maintaining vast equality than about healing suffering bodies and feeding starving children and fixing failing schools, which leads to prisons overpopulated with illiterate children who resorted to a life of crime just to survive. It means walking with Muslims because, duh, you're my neighbor. Following Jesus means being chosen not because I'm special, but because we all have a divine appointment. We are all anointed, all on a mission to heal the land. Faith casts out fear. Kings, at their best, raise the right kind of hell. They upset the apple cart. They set people and the land free to see and worship the God of the universe, because we're all in chains and restless until we find our rest in God. Following Jesus has led me to an interfaith appointment. I didn't set out to be an interfaith activist, but God called me to that. And he chose me for that. And for that, I am blessed. And the love of Jesus compels me, as does the example of Abd el-Qadir, for whom my new fellowship at the University of Virginia is named, a 19th century Islamic leader renowned for sheltering Christians during a massacre in Damascus, and for his compassionate treatment of prisoners of war. I'm honored to walk in his interfaith footsteps. Following Jesus means continuing to stand with you, my Muslim brothers and sisters. Peace be upon you. Thank you very much.